What's going on, family? I'm English.
I'm Ty.
And we're the Normans. And thank you guys so much again for stopping by our channel, for checking us out. We are super, super excited. So tonight, we want you guys to stay tuned and check out, it's kind of a series for us. And we're actually working on how we met and or even right into like the first years of marriage for us.
What actually happened with us. So tonight we want to talk about communication, the importance of that.
Yeah.
And then we
and
also
compromise. Dun, 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 dun. So with that
so
said,
stay tuned and we'll be right there.
Welcome back, ENT family. So thank you guys so much again for stopping by, checking us out. For all of our new family out there, if you guys have not had a chance to subscribe yet, make sure to subscribe below. Make sure that you turn on that notification. Like, comment. We absolutely love your comments. We read every last one of them.
Ask questions.
Yeah, ask questions. If you guys have any questions, you can definitely check us out. Send us an email about it. You know, everything will be listed in the description.
Yep.
But tonight, we're going to be talking about, like we said before, compromise and communication, which are extremely serious for any relationship.
That's right.
So I know with us, when we first got married, well, before we got married, we thought that we communicated great.
I mean, we communicated about going to dinner. We communicated about hanging out with friends, who we were going to hang out with, who was going to be in our circle. So we were good. High five. You think so? But
yeah,
when
we
got married, when we got married, that sort of blew up on us. We thought that we were doing great with communicating with those bare bone items. The moment that we literally got married, things began to change.
It was crazy. It was almost like you're marrying your friend, but
I don't like you.
Yeah, it's like, yo, you are really tripping. Like, seriously tripping. Yeah. It would be small things that, okay, so for example, I told Ty when we first got married, I was like, hey, look, I can't read your mind. So you're going to have to tell me if it's something that you need, if it's something that you're lacking, whatever the case may be, give me the opportunity to make that right or to do that. But you have to communicate. You have to open up and let me know whatever it is. Because, you know, with life, you get to moving and, and shaking
people
and all this
working,
other stuff.
People are going to school.
So it's kind of like sometimes you don't get an opportunity to really pay that much attention, but you know, you have to kind of communicate those things with your spouse or your significant other to kind of let them know, hey, look, this is what's going on with me.
Just to piggyback on starting with communication, that's super duper important.
Yeah, it is.
Like you said, the first time when we got married, I was experiencing some things even before we got married.
Yeah.
I was having some migraines and some other things. I just felt like I wasn't well. I wasn't myself, and I don't have a threshold for pain at all. Anybody that knows me knows that I act like a crybaby. Things are corny to me. I don't want to be bothered. And so what would happen is I would get these headaches. I would have to be in a dark room and so forth, and I wanted him to fix it. We weren't married. We were just in a courting relationship
at that point. I remember that.
Mm-hmm. And I thought that that was literally going to be the end. Like, I mean, I was making him absolutely miserable because I was trying to figure out a way to communicate, hey, I'm in pain. I need help. Can you fix it? But I wasn't saying that. He knew I was in pain because I would go and break away. If we were out and about, I would go and go sit in the car. If he was in a studio session and I was doing like a background for him or something like that, then I would go sit in the car and I would wait and sort of seclude myself away. But in my mind, I'm thinking, okay, if he really cares about me and he really loves me, he ought to just know. Mistake number one, ladies and gentlemen. You cannot presume that the other person is a mind reader. They're not going to know what you need, what you want, what needs to happen unless you open your mouth, take accountability, and really share. And that led up into our marriage. And so a lot of our first years of marriage had to do with me just presuming that he should know already. We had not resolved that issue. So
So, you know, with that, like she brought up that particular scenario, it was crazy because I was just like, yo, and this was right before we got married
that happened.
And I was just like, yo, I was like, if this is what it's gonna be,
I'm good.
Do I even want to do this? Because here I am dealing with another adult, and I'm like, okay, come on. Like, you need to communicate. You have to be able to communicate. And if you cannot effectively do that, then it makes it super difficult for the other person because they don't know what you need and or want.
Absolutely. So, and our settings were a lot different as well. So I think it's very important to share with you guys, family, that the settings that we grew up in, that plays a major part in how you communicate with your spouse, how you communicate with your friends, how you communicate with people that you don't really, really know.
That's true.
For example, English grew up in a household where he had a mom and a dad. They've been married for 30 plus years. Beautiful parents-in-law. Oh, praise God that I got a...
Hey,
I got some gold. Out. We love them dearly. Whereas on my side, I actually was raised by my great grandmother. I was raised by my great grandmother and her children. So my great aunts, great uncles, and things like that. So I did not have a mom and dad. And so things were a little bit different. In my household, the matriarch of our family was actually my great grandmother. And so I was raised with the tools of being a strong woman, you know, make your own money, different things like that. I won't go too much. Yeah. There was a war of the sexes. Right in our house.
It was like a battle. Literally, it was a battle of wills. Mm-hmm. It was, hey, you have this strong, independent woman that is career driven. She has her education. She's working in corporate settings, so on and so forth. And you have this strong man that is an alpha male that also,
total alpha male,
you know, has his head on straight and, you know, he's doing this, that, and the other. And to bring those two people together, the compromise was, hey, you know what? We're going to have to figure out a way to communicate effectively, but to also compromise. So with us compromising, it would be one of those things where let me think about her more than I would think about myself.
And I think that's what really, really saved us, just to be truthful. There were a couple things that came in a few years after we got married. We had to learn really, really quickly because at the point of the year or two, we had been going to therapy. We had been getting the check-ins, you know, with our marriage counselor. And the minister that married us, and she would begin to tell us, you know, you guys really got to think about taking yourself out of the center. You can't be so concerned about what this person is doing, what that person's doing, what they're not doing. You literally, like English said, you have to look at, you know what, how can I give them the advantage? And so that is one of the things that I think was the biggest compromise for us, giving each other the advantage. Because I just felt like, you know what, I ought to have the advantage because, you know, I came into the marriage and he's thinking,
you should just have the advantage.
Yeah. I mean, it's no one advantage over the other. It's I should have the advantage and he should have the advantage. And so in order for us to accomplish that, we literally had to make a quality decision. Hey, I'm not going to think about how he's treating me. I'm going to give him the advantage every single time. Now, I must say we failed at that miserably. But we kept trying. And then over these 8+ years, it's gotten easier and easier just giving each other the advantage.
Yeah.
And those were some of the first things. There are no words for the devastation that came with us having things like our first real arguments. Things that were so super minute and we just took them and blew them out of proportion. So,
petty,
you know,
is what it was.
It was super petty. It was absolutely petty. We would get into an argument on things like, you know, if he went into the kitchen, he got himself something to drink, and I was in the house somewhere. I'm like, oh, okay. Oh, well, where's my cup? It's like, you don't have a cup. I didn't get your cup.
For anything to drink.
Yeah, or he would make himself something to eat, and I'm like, oh, you know, well, surely he's down there cooking, and it's smelling really good. My husband can cook, y'all. Let's just be clear about that. When he put the seasonings together, it's just a... It's just a force to be reckoned with, but nonetheless, on a more serious note, some of our really, really weird arguments would be behind things like food. He would go in and he would make himself something to eat. And I'm like, surely he's been down there for 30, 45 minutes. He's preparing something. He got all the food groups, but he only got one plate, y'all.
But you know what? It wasn't even like that. It was, hey, you know what? She's been out all day.
I'm thinking she got something. I've been out
all day. And more than likely, she's already eaten. So if I don't ask her this time around if she wants something to eat, it should be okay. Mm-hmm. And that could just very well have been, hey, you know what? I want to grab a turkey sandwich or whatever the case may be. She felt as though, oh, if you're grabbing one, you should just automatically grab me one.
Or ask me.
That's not how that works.
Yeah, ask me.
The compromise was, hey, you know what? Let me ask her. Even if she says
it's not gonna hurt.
No, let me ask her.
Let me ask him. It's not gonna hurt. If I go in the kitchen, I say, hey babe, I'm down here. You know, did you want me to grab you something? You want me to bring you up
did
something?
Did you want anything for the kitchen? You know, whatever the case.
So that's
something that we had to learn. It's like kind of like, hey, you know what? I like to be included. Mm-hmm. In whatever is going on. Mm-hmm. And it's like, okay, look, I won't look into include you, but
I'll include you.
I will include you now that you have communicated to me that you would like to be included.
And that's where the effective communication comes into play, because you really got to communicate those things that are important to you.
To you as an individual person.
You know, how you want to be communicated to. The world calls it languages of love, or the five love languages and things like that. Yeah. That plays a major role, just figuring out if this person likes adoration, if this person likes gifts, or whatever the case might be, or how you exemplify your love for them. Yeah. You have to know that coming in. But one of the cool things about what we established early on was submission. Now, ladies and gentlemen, it's just so near and dear to my heart. And the reason why, and I don't want to get emotional on you, family, but it really, really helped to save my marriage, point blank period. I mentioned it earlier before, a friend of mine, and I won't call out any names, really blessed me tremendously by allowing me to come into a Bible study where I learned sort of one-on-one directly with somebody who had been married for, 50 plus years?
50 plus years, man.
And how things were for them. And then over the next several weeks, this dear heart committed to teaching a group of us who had been married, me who was newly married, just what that looks like. It doesn't mean that we're a doormat, and I won't get into that tonight, but I believe that that was one of the things that saved my marriage, because I'm thinking to myself, if I can learn how to bow out gracefully, if you will, put my dukes down and not want to fight all the time, this might be the thing. And when I adopted, you know, submission and just learned the importance of it, why it was put in place in the first place and just different things, you know, I learned to look at him and say, you know what, giving him the advantage actually gives me the advantage, because when he's happy, I'm happy. And it helped me to also squash the thing of happy wife, happy life. It's a total lie. Again, we won't get into that, but I did bring it to English's attention. Happy wife, happy life gets into something that's a little bit more of an imbalance, and we'll have a whole series episode
surrounded around
happy
wife, happy life, and that whole syndrome and why it is not true.
My microphone is on.
It is not true. It is not so far from the truth.
I bought it to his attention.
We're going to talk about it in a whole other episode. Why we feel as though it is not true. Mm-hmm. And we'll actually give you some biblical things and some things that we found surrounding that as well. Yeah. But as far as that submission piece, what I will say is, ladies and gentlemen, it is not for the weak at heart.
It is
like,
not.
Like, honestly, the it truth be told, it's not for the weak at heart, because it's one of those things where it's like, you're literally laying down. You're laying it all down for the other person. Mm-hmm. And so many people have this issue with, hey, I don't want to be that vulnerable with the person that I'm married to, because I don't want them to take advantage of me.
Sure.
So therefore, they will not submit. Mm-hmm. And submission is not just for women. It's for men and women both. Mm-hmm. So it's one of those things where it's like, again, going back to the battle of the wheels. Somebody has to give in, or both of y'all are going to end up at divorce court.
which is
somebody's
going to
end up at divorce court. You're not going
to
walk down the aisle. He's going to take your ring back. You're going to walk out, run out of the church, or whatever the case may be.
That's just too much drama.
But when you can just say, you know what?
I'll compromise.
I'll submit the way that I need to submit. And submission is only saying, hey, I'm going to give this person the advantage. Mm-hmm. So when it comes to me thinking about myself first, I'll no longer think about myself first, but I'll think about her before I think about myself. Again, I know that it's getting super, super good, but we have a lot more to share with you guys, and it's getting juicier by the moment. So what we're going to do is we're going to stop it here. Mm-hmm. On the very next episode or the very next vlog, we'll actually go right back into communication and compromise. And we'll share even a little bit more about our experiences. But for all of our ENT family, all of our new family that has just joined us, thank you guys so much. We absolutely appreciate you. Guys, again, make sure that you turn on your notifications. Make sure to subscribe below. Mm-hmm. Leave us comments. You can send us emails. If you have questions, we'll be more than happy to answer those questions for you to the best of our ability. ENT family, thank you guys so much for rocking with us, and we're going to be back.
Absolutely.
All right. Peace.